invited back. I remember this room. I trained in this room some years ago. We're going to find out exactly how many. But also in the first cottage up here, as you turn in, I used to meet with your team on standardized documentation down in the basement. And in the years, I'm trying to remember, I don't know if it was 99, 2000, we're not quite sure. But it's great to be back. What a beautiful campus you have. And I want to thank Jean for her help and support in getting us here and ready. I also want to thank Nancy and Jim, who are part of your staff this morning. You came in and got your food ready and everything. Thank you all very much and helped me set up. I want to thank them as well. It's a pleasure to be with you. We've got a full day. And Dale, as you said, it's a full day. We've got several different segments of information. The first segment this morning in the first hour is really to look at this whole concept of healthcare and what's happening nationally to us, certainly here in Ohio as well. How do we prepare for it? What are we seeing as trends? It's been my privilege over the last 22 years as a consultant to work with over 750 centers in 47 states, Canada, and the Netherlands. So we have a lot of information from different states that we work with every day. Our team of 11 consultants works, and I think David Swan has been here to work with you. You are approved, and from our Los Angeles office, will be working with you on your gap analysis. We're going to talk about that after lunch today. But the whole point here is to try to bring to you information that might be helpful. There's no right or wrong in this information. It's about how do we prepare and how do we start strategically thinking differently. Because would you agree with me, we are in a different environment. Is that fair to say? It's not like it was in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s. You know, we talked about change at that time. You know, when I started in 91, we were talking about change, but nothing compared to the change that we've seen since the Affordable Care Act passed in 2010. And I think what's happened is the states individually have changed so much within a state, a la Missouri. You know, every one of the 27 little health centers we've worked with for years are now health homes, and they all have a real requirement to provide care management coordination, which we'll talk about with your QI team. How does that look? They're also on shared risk payments. We're going to talk about shared risk payments. And we're also going to talk about the new PPS, prospective payment system, which we'll be moving to as certified community behavioral health clinics. Again, our whole concept of how we're paid and why we're paid is really shifting. So strategically this morning, I wanted to point out, these slides have been sent, so hopefully it looks like you have the copies. Very good. Moving to carve-out waivers, I know that Illinois just enacted, but the 1115 carve-in waivers, excuse me, not carve-out, are really the hot button right now. Alabama has moved to carve-ins. What does that mean? It means the old behavioral health departments, the old behavioral health divisions, are no longer have an importance as they had historically. Example, here in Ohio, what happened a couple of years ago in July? Your Department of Mental Health, Office of Mental Health and Office of Alcohol and Drug Services got what? They got moved from their cabinet level position over to what department? Anybody with me? Everybody with me? But before July, 2 years ago, you had a cabinet position for mental health, and your governor appointed that position. You no longer have that. What does that mean? It means that you're moving over to health and human services. And that means we're going to look at all of health care, not just behavioral. It's no longer a carve-out governance in Louisiana. All the Department of Mental Health, Department of Alcohol and Drug Services is gone. California abolished its Department of Mental Health October 2 years ago. Now, why is all that happening? Because what they're saying is, no longer are we going to carve out administration, we're not going to carve out funding for you under what we used to call the old carve-out dollars, the Medicaid, or rehab options, which you had, the MROs in your state. We're going to carve all that money into a pot called Medicaid, and we're going to let everybody come together and get the dollars. So it means that we no longer have, candidly, protection from carve-out dollars. Everybody follow that concept? And it's almost like, be careful what you ask for, because we want it to be integrated into healthcare, become part of mainstream healthcare, but in so doing, a lot of our governance and a lot of our protections that we didn't like it sometimes, but some of those are going away. Alabama, Arkansas, Kansas. Kansas now has three MCOs that manages all of physical health and behavioral health. And you get all of your authorizations from the same three MCOs. You go to Alabama, they're going to put physical health, dental health, oral health, behavioral health, and IDD health together into one pot of money. And you get a PMPM that will have six what they call regional comprehensive care entities, CCEs. And those CCEs are going to manage all dollars for all health. So the point here is the care management piece of the MCOs in Kansas, the care management piece of the MCOs in North Carolina, really are dealing with care coordination, care management at the MCO level. And that's for physical health, behavioral health, dental in some cases, including now North Carolina. But basically they're saying the entire health needs of the Medicaid eligible are to be dealt with by one care management care organization, care management structure, management organization. That's what we call 1115 Carbon. That out of that also we have accountable care organizations. At first they were Medicare only. And these ACOs are provided as a provision of the Affordable Care Act in 10. But basically it's a hospital, 50 primary care physicians working with 5,000 patients for at least 3 years, and they're called shared risk, shared savings. I'll get into that more. But in the case of Medicaid, the ACOs have now been added where Medicaid is an ACO. Example, I had a behavioral health center director stop me at the conference in Washington a couple of weeks ago, whenever that was, 1st of May, I guess. And basically said, we've been notified by an MCO they want us to be the primary provider for Medicaid under an ACO arrangement. ACO is simply this. You get paid a shared savings or a shared risk. You get paid a bundle. You no longer get paid fee-for-service. And so when we start talking about these payment transitions, it's going to require you, the leaders, to start thinking about how to manage your care and your cost very differently. So ACOs, I think the last time I had was 165 have been certified, four in North Carolina. 14 plus states have applied for Section 2703, which is the health home, and your state has applied for that. State of New York has applied for that. State of North Carolina has applied for that. State of Missouri is all health homes. But that says we're going to integrate into a health home environment, both physical and behavioral care. And we're going to do that through certain procedures under Section 2703 that pays you for separate services, care management, care coordination. Again, we'll talk about those this afternoon. FQHCs are continuing to grow. It's very important that you're aware of that strategically because a lot of effort, a lot of money. Remember that FQHCs, the health home movement, received $11 billion new dollars with the Affordable Care Act. Did everybody catch that number? Billion is in Barbara Bill. Okay? The point of that was to grow their behavioral health capacity, expand their clinics, and bring in more people. The goal under the Behavioral Health Affordable Care Act is for them to move from serving 19.5 million Americans in 2010 to 2015, which is only one year away, they're supposed to be serving 40 million. They're supposed to double their capacity in 5 years with that $11 billion in new funding. Now guess how much the mental health block grants and the alcohol drug block grants received out of the Affordable Care Act? How many new dollars? Not a penny. So what's the message? What's the message from Congress? Integrated settings. One-stop shops. That's where they want us to go. And so as we look at that, as you look at that concept, back to health homes, as you look at the integration of the 1115 waivers, it's all moving seemingly into an area where we are going to have to play well with new partners strategically. And we're going to have a capacity to serve them. Make sense? Example, ACO, just to give you one quick strategic challenge. I was engaged by six behavioral health centers in the Quad State area for three major very large centers. They had all applied for ACO status, and these centers wanted to be their primary provider for behavioral health. All three hospital systems, medical centers, had behavioral health capacity. So what they were trying to say is, don't build more capacity, use us. Make sense? Now why? Because if they don't use us, what's our future? It's called sitting on the sideline of a parade walking by and you realize the parade's over and you're not on the float or didn't create a float. It's a pretty lonely situation. You know, what's my role now? And so I met, took me 6 months to get a meeting with the three administrators, all of the staff in the mental health centers, and we sat there and we started talking about how many years we've been in business and how many people we've helped. We did a lot of good. We kept talking about a lot of good. And finally, one administrator asked a question. He said, I know you've been in business a long time. He said, but what's your time and cost of treatment? What did we say? 6 minutes. Let me ask you, what's your time and cost of treatment here? Now, Joy Ruth on our team is going to help you figure that out. And she's going to help you figure out how many different ways you're bringing people to treatment, how many different questions you're asking that you don't need to answer. Everybody with me? Because when we talk about customer service, we've got to start looking at treatment. And what one of the mental health centers said, director said, well, you know, we bring people in and we give them a 2-hour intake and then we staff their case. Are you all familiar with this whole process? And then we refer them to a clinician. That sometimes takes 3 or 4 weeks to get them into their caseload. And this guy stopped him. He said, I'm not paying for that. That's not treatment. That's process. You see, what we've confused is process with treatment. And what customer service requires is treatment. And what the ACOs are, because they're at risk financially, they're not going to pay you for that process. So you've got to start looking at what are we doing now that we may have been doing for 40 years that everybody loves, the staff, but it may not be serving your customer. Make sense, everybody? The next major change in the horizon, excellence in mental health, that passed in March of this year, an excellent opportunity for us. Basically, there will be 8 states selected. I gave you this slide up here. I can give you the website for the National Council, but $25 million in grants for 8 states to plan for 2 years to basically certify behavioral health clinics. Now, the important part of this law is that if the state feels that the current behavioral health centers cannot be certified, they have authority by the federal government to establish new clinics and or identify other clinics that will become their certified behavioral health clinics. Everybody catch what I just said? Because there will be national criteria set. Those national criteria will be established by September 1st. Those criteria will be same-day access will be one of them. And the whole model of moving from we're going to schedule you, it's really a clinical shift team from scheduling people as a solution to their need to actually seeing them. That's a real shift culturally. Alan Harder, executive director of a team out in Pennsylvania, they went the same day 2.5 years ago, and he stopped me in Washington and he said, David, it's changed our clinical culture forever. Because we now realize we have capacity to see people instead of scheduling people. And that's a real shift in your thinking and in the management of your staff's time and the management of your time. So that concept of same day. Those standards will be issued, and then 8 states will apply or be given a grant, and then in 2017 they basically will be notified, and they will then basically move to a certified behavioral health clinic. Their payment system will shift from fee-for-service to prospective payment system. That's PPS. The only two entities now that get PPS are FQHCs. What does that mean? FQHCs receive a payment for a visit, regardless of how long it lasts. So if you come to see an MSW, they get $49.71 that day. If they stay 20 minutes, if they stay 2 hours and 20 minutes, guess what they get paid? $49.71. Okay? Now, if they see a psychiatrist or an OBGYN, it's $105. So again, whatever they stay, this 20-minute appointment or an hour and a half, that's what they get paid. More importantly, when they come for that day, you cannot provide any other ancillary services to that client. In other words, this is what they get. Now, why is that important? The PPS system is cost-based reimbursement. And so FQHC's example, the FQHC that our mental health center owns and operates in East Texas gets paid $120, because every center is different because it's based on your local cost. So it could be different across your different centers within the state. But they get paid $125 for a psych med follow-up visit. The mental health system two blocks away gets paid $47 for the same follow-up in the old behavioral health fee-for-service system. So what you're getting is typically more money because it's cost-based reimbursement. But that prospective payment system is going to change, this is the bullet here, it's going to change us to start thinking about cost and how to reduce cost, how to maintain cost, because what I was working on for the presentation from Missouri, I'll be there in 3 weeks, on the PPS system, because they're going to be actively applying, because they're all behavioral health homes, they're going to apply for one of these. Missouri is really the governmental state officials, The state must apply, not the behavioral health center. But they're collaborating to get the state in position to apply for it. But they want to be one of the eight states. Now, why? Because they'll have cost-based reimbursement. And secondly, they will be certified in a whole new model of care that we have never seen before in the behavioral health world. And so, again, back to Ohio. What is going to be your posture in terms of your center, but also collaborating with others in your state? Do you want to be one of those eight states? Okay? Now, the concept that we're seeing a real shift in is moving from just fee-for-service to a shared risk funding. And that means we're shifting from paying for volume to paying for value, quality slash value. I'm going to define that for you and talk about what the dynamics are when we start moving from volume. We get paid a bed day rate in a group home. We get paid an hourly rate if we're on hourly rate. We get paid a 15-minute unit rate, whatever the rates are. And if we deliver X number of services that are, in quote, authorized, we expect to be paid. What shared risk says is we're not going to pay you that way anymore. We're going to pay you for the value you produce. It's a real shift in thinking. Now, where is this occurring? All the affordable accountable care organizations, ACOs, are on shared risk already. I'll give you case studies of that. All of the health homes are on a PMPM. No more fee-for-service, and that's been your hang-up here and you're moving to your health home in Ohio. What do they want to do? Give you a PMPM for care management, care coordination, but take away your community psychiatric support. Y'all remember that dialogue last year, the year before? So they're trying to pull back the ability for you to build fee-for-service, which is your ability to pay for all your expenses, and so we're just going to pay you this much over here. Was it 326 or whatever it was?
It was.
It's really low. So the point I'm making is all of this says we're no longer going to just pay you for volume. You've got to come to the table with some value. So let's talk about that value. Bundle rates, episodes of care rates, are shared risk typical, stratified case rates. For instance, in Kansas, the three MCOs have notified the 27 behavioral health centers that affected this July, which is in just a couple of months, or one of the MCOs, two of them for next January, they're no longer going to pay a fee-for-service reimbursement. They'll basically pay for a population. What that means is someone with bipolar disorder is a population. Okay? And we're going to pay you so much per member per month to serve them. If they get better, you get more money. If they get worse or don't get better, you lose some of that money. Everybody understand shared risk now? It's basically a little bit different, Deborah. It's a good question. It's a little bit different in the sense that the old DRG is what you got paid, but there were no outcomes attached to it. For instance, what's your post-operative infection rates? What is your readmission rate post 30 days? Now the ACOs are being held to those standards. Example, if I'm I'm a Medicare eligible, I had a knee replacement 2 years ago as Medicare eligible after the Affordable Care Act. I had four calls from care managers post-discharge. Are you going to rehab? Are you taking your meds? Do you need to see the doctor? I had the same procedure 9 years before on the other knee, not one call. Now, why do they call me? Because readmission or post-operative infection rate drives their revenue on the bundled payment down. Okay? Under the Affordable Care Act, starting in October of 11, they lose 1% to 2% of their rate for bad outcomes under Medicare. By 2017, they lose up to 4% of their rate. Most hospitals operate at a 4 to 5% profit margin. So if I'm losing 4% of my income on Medicare clients, which is going to be more and more for most hospitals, I can't survive. And so these hospitals are really being tasked to produce outcomes. The old DRG is you just had a cost-based reimbursement. This says we're going to give you a cost-based or a reimbursement based on historical, but Deborah, you've got to show us that people are getting better. And if they're not getting better based on our standards, we're going to take some of that money back. Everybody with me? Very different model. Case rates are typically, Vermont has gone all community-based support now. Community psychiatric support is case rate in Vermont. In Rhode Island, same thing. Most of New England has gone to case rates. No more fee-for-service. You get so much per person per month. The problem with that is you've got to internally, in your UM functioning, make sure that some people aren't getting a lot of service and some people aren't getting any. Are you all familiar with that trend? It's the old squeaky wheel. I got to average it across my caseload based on what the average cost are. Okay. Now, here's exactly this concept of paying for volume. To pay for value or quality requires an integration. And team, this is critical for us because in many of our siloed concepts of organizational structure, you know, finance is over here, clinical is over there, IT is back here. Are y'all familiar with all this? And we really haven't had to pull together. Some of us, are y'all familiar with Hatfields and McCoys up here in Ohio? Yes. A little humor. That's my tender humor, okay? But the Hatfields and McCoys means that basically, sometimes we don't get along too well internally. Because we're going to talk about that in the customer service section. And the problem with that now is that I've got to have clinical, quality, outcomes, financial, all together in the same room. I need to look at, because when I come to this value equation, I've got to look at the cost of the service tied to the outcomes we achieve, and could we achieve better outcomes with less cost? Everybody with me? That's where we're going. That's called bending the cost curve. So it's no longer just giving them services. It's about if we give them, use this evidence-based practice, or we use this level of care benefit design, and we do it this way, can we achieve outcomes, and what outcomes? So we've got to start having outcomes to our outcomes. Are y'all familiar with what I'm saying? Because we've had outcomes for years, but could you agree it doesn't really impact what we do pretty well? If I asked one QI director at the state, I said, where are your outcomes? She said, the state outcomes are on my credential. And I said, well, that's good. I said, so let me ask another question. This morning at 10 o'clock, how are those outcomes that you collected now for the last 4 years affecting clinical staffings around your state this morning? And she said, really quick, that's not the purpose of that. I said, well, so what's the purpose? She said, we're supposed to have outcomes. Those days are gone. And we're going to really have to show that people are getting better. And how are they getting better? That's the key. Here's that Medicare case study. I mentioned it's plus one, minus one, 2% swing. In 2017, it goes to plus two, minus two. And it's, again, pay-for-performance modeling, where if you, they call it race to the top, but if you have high post-operative infection rates, high IV infection rates, high readmission rates by 30 days, you lose money based on the formula under the Affordable Care Act. That's what's coming with the shared risk.
Now, you said Race to the Top?
Race to the Top is the name of the national initiative.
I was about to say, it's the same as an educational initiative, Race to the Top.
This is within a hospital system serving Medicare. It started, but now Medicaid as well. ACOs. But it's called Race to the Top, is the internal nomenclature. I assume that could be, as you said, applied to education or whatever. So we have to have a dynamic tension between cost and quality. And this is important. When I started, and Deborah referred to this, when I started my work in 91, I was not well-liked in the behavioral health industry. What was not? Because I talked about the need to understand the cost of the process as well as the outcome. And what I was basically, people said at that time, all you're interested in is cost. All you're interested in is productivity. Y'all familiar with those? And many of you may have said this, and that's fine. But here's my point, and what I was saying then, and I'm still saying today, there has to be a tension. And managers, I've got to know what my quality is, yes, but I've also got to know what my cost is. And if my costs are not in line with what someone is willing to pay me for that process, then I have to figure out a way to fund it, because I'm losing money in every process. Example, in our same-day access models, most of our centers, the average, you know, we've done over 3,000 gap analysis across the country. We're averaging about $355 on average from first call for treatment to treatment plan completion, routine. $355. Guess what? On average, we're getting paid nationally for that process. $125 to $130. So how have we funded the $300, $200 loss? Grants. Everybody with me? That model will not work into our future. Those ACOs are going to pay you for it. They're not going to pay you for process. They've already said that. We're going to pay you for treatment. So as we start to look at this, I've got to look at this tension. How much quality can I afford based on what someone's willing to pay me for? So that tension swings like a pendulum. All quality, all cost. I'm not advocating all costs. I'm advocating somewhere in the middle here, or somewhere in this pendulum, how much can we provide? For instance, I need a 55-minute diagnostic assessment. I don't need a 2.5-hour diagnostic assessment either. Does that make sense? Now what? Nobody will pay for it. Now I've got to look at state standards. I've got to look at how am I meeting state standards, and Joy's going to do all of that with you and data map you. But we're going to have to start looking at what are we doing internally that will change what we've been doing to meet the guidelines. And I'll give the team this afternoon some guidelines nationally. That quality and cost. Everybody understand the tension. It's not one or the other. Yes?
One of the things that's been difficult in behavioral health is that there's no agreement about, you know, what the outcomes should be in terms of quality. Do you see us developing a national outcome measurement system that where everyone is going to have the same outcome?
I think you're exactly right. Because our blessing is we have hundreds, if not thousands, of outcome measures. Probably three more will be produced today. It's somewhere in our country. Our curse is the same thing. Is that we have so many different versions of outcomes and ways to look at it, we have no comparable data. So the National Council asked us, I met Willa Fernandez with the DLA 20 back in the 90s, mid-90s. I was very impressed with it, looked at functionality around daily living activities. And the reason I was impressed is it didn't deal with symptoms. It talked about how the signs and symptoms impacted their functionality, but then I could take that into a comorbid situation with the major depression and diabetes. I can look at their functionality around both of those illnesses. So what the DLA 20 has become is a recommended national model. State of Missouri has adopted it for all their health homes. State of Kansas has now adopted it. State of Utah, state of North Dakota has adopted it. West part of New York has adopted it. And what you're seeing with those measures is that you're starting to look at, are people getting better, or are they able to function better? And this afternoon, I'm going to show you some actual case study outcome from a couple of national grants, advancing standard of care grants that we've managed. Under treatment target, 6 months, what can you do in 6 months to improve functionality? Again, some persons we know will have symptoms or some level of symptoms the rest of their life. And I think the challenge we've had is so many of our measures are based on symptoms. And really, it's the question is, can we help someone manage the symptoms differently and in their daily living? So I would say if I had to guess it today, is DLA 20. I know the council has asked us to create a national website for them, and they're using the DLA 20 as that model. Until we agree to that, though, and that's why most states, like your Ohio, what you really need to do in Ohio is sit down with all of the LACA and all the others and agree on one measure. Agree on one measure, and that's going to have a lot of people upset. Are y'all familiar with upset? Yeah, there's going to be a lot of people upset. Well, I like my basis, you know, I like my hands, I like my, you know, but somehow we've got to come together and say, what are we going to agree, and then will the MCO agree? Back to who's going to be managing this care, back to that model, okay? No problem. I trust you. Medicaid went with it. That's what we found in Kansas. Same thing in Utah. but sometimes they do have it. But I don't know that it's ironclad as much as can you produce for them or show them how your use of this measure could give them better quality information and help your clinicians, because the DLA-20 also helps you in treatment planning. It really talks about where we're going to go next, what do we focus on, and I'll talk about that in a second. Okay? But I think that's a changing environment. The other thing is, remember, in your cost, it's not the rate, it's the net. It's what you actually collect. And it's very important when we look at cost as to what we look at net collected. Meaning if we're billing third party and we've got a 22% denial rate, we're not collecting the X dollars that we're billing. We're getting 22% less, and that's your net rate. Does everybody understand that concept? So Scott Lloyd and our team works with cost finding. We just are now doing cost finding for all centers in Georgia. We're cost finding all the centers in Kansas around CPT code by staff type. Now, why? Because this is the value of care equation. This is so important. This model, and the council is asking me to write something on this now, but the services provided is one element. It's like a three-legged type of stool. I need to know what services I'm providing. That could be an evidence-based practice. It could be a level of care criteria. We'll talk about that this afternoon. It could be a benefit design. But basically, I am providing certain services. The question is then, is what is the cost of that service per CPT code by staff type? If I'm doing a med follow-up with an APRN versus an MD, what are my cost differentials? And what's my reimbursement differential? In Kansas, there's a difference. They reimburse less for the APRN than the MD. But what is my cost by staff type and CPT code? And it's real, real important, because now I then have to look at the outcomes achieved. How do we demonstrate that people are getting better? Back to your question. You know, how can we demonstrate people are getting better? Is it based on their functioning level? Are they functioning better in school? You know, they're performing better. They're not they're not having been arrested. They're not in the court systems. You know, they've been moved along in that area of their life. But what have they achieved? Now, here's the value information. Based on the services provided and the cost of those services specifically with the outcomes, can you produce the same or better outcomes for less cost? That's the challenge. And it may not be you as much as someone down the street says, we can do it better than Beech would. We can actually produce this outcome at less cost because our practice, our service array, our practice is different. Everybody with me? The focus here is not on how many services you provide, old fee for service. The focus is what? Can you produce any outcome? Questions about this concept? This is a critical piece, this three-legged stool I got into my services. Would you agree we pretty well know that in our system? We got evidence-based practice, we're going to do this, you know, here's our level of care, our benefit design, we got all that. Our cost, how are we doing with that in our system? By CPT code, by staff type. Pardon? Now, why is that critical? Because that's how you determine the value. You know, if you're creating an outcome, but it's costing you $1,000, you know, we had one team, and I must tell you, they were doing a 3.5-hour intake assessment in a child agency. And I said, why are you doing this 3.5-hour intake? They said, because it's quality. I said, but 51% of your clients never show back up after the intake. And they said, we know that, but what we're trying to do is collect as much information as we can before they leave, because we know we'll never see them again. I want you to think about that one for just a second. See, that's absence of cost. Have no concept of tension with cost. We just know it's quality. And everybody wanted to ask all those questions. Y'all familiar with this? But we have no idea what it costs us. Now, Joy is going to share with you your cost. And you're going to, I think, will be surprised. Because what you've got to come to grips with is, can you sustain that in your future? That's the question under these kinds of models. Questions about this equation, please.
Could you define staff type? Is that more in reference to
MD? It's by licensure. MD versus advanced practitioner for medical side, or RN. Can the RN be doing something the MD's doing? So what you've got to start looking at is efficient staff usage and defining their roles. Why do we have an MD doing this when an RN can do it? Those then become defining role defining. Why do we have an LCSW doing this when an MSW non-licensed could do it? our QMHP could do it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Based on the funder, why do we have someone in therapy where the therapist hasn't seen the client, but periodically, but when they come, they're really doing crisis, kind of crisis intervention. Why don't we give it to a bachelor's level case manager? This isn't therapy. So you've got to start thinking, what is therapy? What is the role of the therapist? Because that's more costly, typically. And also, from a compliance standpoint, we can get in more trouble, as we found out in New Mexico, when we really aren't providing individual therapy, we're providing case management content, but charging it as therapy. So you've got to start looking at the compliance piece, but also the cost piece. Can my advanced practitioner, for instance, if I have four levels of clients, a level four is very difficult, you know, and I need my MDs there, but my level one clients, stable, long-term, been on the same meds for a while, why is an MD seeing them? Why not an advanced practitioner? Because I can cut my costs and produce the same outcome. That's the question. Does that help?
Yep.
So it's really about managing resources very different than we've ever thought about. It's almost like before, would you agree we became all to all? All of our LCSWs became case managers, all of our case managers became QMHPs almost, all of our MDs did all, we had everybody doing everything, and you're going to have to really redefine and refine your approach based on what? And what's going to drive it? It's not, do we have a verbal discussion subjectively about should we have an MD versus an APR? You're going to have to know your cost per CPT code and staff type to understand that you cannot afford to do this way anymore. Until you get to that level of objectivity, you will go round and round in meetings. Y'all familiar with round and round? And you will get higher and higher above C-level. See, C-level is where your costs are. What we tend to do in behavioral health is we stay 10,000 feet above sea level because we don't know our cost. And you have to know it. And Scott Lloyd can work with you on that if you want to know your cost. Be glad to have him contact you. But at some point, you've got to get real with your cost because that's how you're going to be judged in value. Why? Because your payers are being paid based on value. They're not being paid based on volume. Questions or thoughts? It's a very important equation. Now, when I take this into customer service, what's the real important part of customer service here? I need to have access, same-day access. I need to get people in. I need to treat them well. I need to have customer loyalty because there will be others who will say, what? We can do what Beech was doing, and we can do it at a better cost. We can produce the same outcomes at a better cost. And that's the funders. That gets the funders here. That's what the year starts to team with. Back to that model will go. Okay, so you can do that at lower cost? Yeah, and that's called bending the cost curve in the affordable care. Questions or thoughts? Our historical leadership, and I want to talk about this because I want you to really think about it. Here are the historical leadership challenges I've dealt with for 22, 23 years now. Is it, you know, HR issue, performance behavior, turning in documentation, that's been a never-ending process. Are y'all familiar with that? I was working at a team the other day, and I said, so how many people do you have not turning in on time? They said, well, about the same 25. And I said, and they got their names. Did anybody understand this concept? I said, don't name them out loud. Can you write them? Oh, sure, we can write them. And I said, so how long have y'all been discussing this? And this lady said, since I've been here. And I said, how long have you been here? And she said, 21 and a half years. And I said, how long do you plan to discuss it into your future? Because if you got these noise levels, see, these challenges, never-ending challenges that you don't resolve, create a system noise. And the system noise does not allow you to be a leader. Because the minute you walk in with your fresh ideas on leadership, you're right back into the weeds. Leadership sees the horizon. Where are you going? Where is Beech Brook going? Where is my program within Beech Brook going? That's a leadership model. But when I'm right back into Susie and Bill won't turn in their paperwork, and I'm right back into that supervision, which we talked about, or I don't talk about it with Susie and Bill because I've talked about it so long, I'm embarrassed to bring it back up again. Are y'all familiar with that? This is yes, and this is no. We're not going to change it all day. Exactly. In fact, one of the Nelson Burris, I asked him to present it to Cole. You know, his business model, which we're going to talk about today too, his business model is that every manager is a leader, and every manager has to make their own decisions with guidance. But it's not about passing all the decisions up and passing all the decisions back down. We don't have time to do that. But the point I'm making is you You are the leaders. I went to the embassy suites this morning, and I said in the breakfast room, I said, are there any leaders of Beech, Brook out here?
A lot of people eat about it.
And they said, oh no, they'll all be in the meeting room over at Beech, Brook this morning. You see, you're it. There are no other leaders. Do you understand that concept? Can you get a grasp on that? And if Beech, Brook doesn't make this turn, don't look outside this room. It's about you, and it's about you making decisions as leaders that you can't keep doing if it's not working. If it's working, keep doing it. But if it's not working, what are you going to do about it? But you can't debate and beat each other up for 6 months talking about it. Are you all familiar with debate and beat each other up? Are you? I mean, really, are you? You don't deserve that, do you? You don't deserve that. You're nice people. You're good people. You don't deserve that atmosphere. And what you really need to start doing is saying, we need objective measurement. And when Joy lays out your costs and how many different processes you have at Beech, Brook, you're going to have to choose one. And you're going to have to choose one that's within the cost parameters of how you can afford to keep doing it and getting people in on time. That's not personal. It's a business clinical decision. Does that make sense? It's not personal anymore. It's about how do we get people into care and how do we meet the outcomes that are needed. See, this system noise prevents me, and this is important, it prevents me from making these kinds of leadership decisions. And that's where we are today. If you look at that slide, there are some challenging requirements there. I've been talking about some of them. But if you look at that, I've got to see how I can work in an integrated care team. What's my role in that? What's the role of the behaviorist? What's the role of the MD? Or the advanced practitioner, the RN? What's the role? How do I shift from volume to value? Those are questions, and this is important to you. As long as I'm still dealing with these core behavioral, performance, aptitude, and attitude issues, I cannot lead. Everybody catch what I just said? As long as all my energy is spent trying to get people to do their job, and it's been a never-ending discussion, this afternoon I'm going to talk about in customer service, I'm going to talk about attitude. Attitude, we put up with some tremendously difficult attitudes, would you agree? Some of our behaviors of our staff, tremendously difficult. Some of our staff are more crisis than our clients. Is that true? And I'm not being cruel here, team, I'm just being honest with you. You've got to get beyond that. You can't be absorbed. Your energy can't be absorbed. Your ideas, you know, I was taught in 1971 as a CEO of a multinational company, my first career for 25 years, that I only had so much creative energy in the day. And when it was used up, it was gone. And what I found when I got to the Behavioral Health Center coming out of private industry, all my energy was taken with, oh, I got a problem. Did you build it and turn it in? We're right back to talking about what we talked about 2 weeks ago. Anybody familiar with this? If it's too personal, roll your eyeballs. This is yes. Just look up when you do it. But can you catch me? And as long as those issues create system noise, you cannot appropriately spend the time as a leader you need on these core issues. That's core for today. You take nothing away from today. So back to 91, 92, when I was talking about performance standards and key performance indicators and job descriptions, there was a reason for it. And that is to get past all the noise. How much noise do y'all have here? And that's not a healthy work environment, would you agree? Emotionally or physically? Would you agree? I'm just asking. You've got to address it. And you've got to get beyond, I'm afraid somebody's going to be upset. You've got to get beyond it. This is about how does each group move into the future, and how do you as a leader in your respective role take it to the future. That's what this is about. It's not about a personal thing at all. Okay? The pace of change, and what I'm going to talk about now, is the pace of change is so significant. The medical homes and health care organizations, number one and two, I've said all that, so I don't need to read it. But what we're finding is we have to have certain values. And what the community behavioral health clinics, and that new term is certified community behavioral health clinics, CCBHCs. That's the term under law, so I assume that's what we're going to be called. But the point is, it's now in law, and for the first time in statute and law, we are recognized by the federal government. Do y'all realize that? We never had a statute naming us, a statute giving us requirements. We had policy and procedures and regulations, but we now have a federal law. As I said, FQHCs are on the PPS system, rural health centers are on the PPS system, and we'll be paying PPS. So there are only three that are cost-based reimbursement. Our values we have to be accessible. And that means to treatment, not to process. I've got to get them to treatment. Would you all agree the VA is struggling today? What's their struggle? And I'll talk about it in customer service.
Waiting list.
But what's happened to them is they focused on their system more than the system that was supposed to support the customer. And their system of how they're internally rigging this and doing that so that they look good was more important evidently than serving the client. Everybody with me? So this shift has got to be accessible to treatment. We got to be efficient, highest possible quality. We have to be connected. We have to share core clinical information. We need to be EMR and HR that will do that with other providers. We need to be accountable, reduce clinical outcomes, and we need to be resilient. We must look at how to look at alternative payments. And even to the point, in Kansas, we were able to get the MCO's approval, Deborah, that if we came up with a shared risk model, and we're creating, David Swan's working on this now, along with Scott Lloyd on costing, but two models, the MCOs will go with, as long as they're reasonable, with reasonable outcomes. So there's no pat answer here, it's how can you invent or create and lead the industry in some tremendous flux. Right now, we've got a chance to lead because no one has all the answers. Does that make sense? Those are the values that we have to have. I want you to look at this one, and this is a very important. I'd be glad to give you any of this in a hard copy. I have what we call an assessment historical change tool. It's an e-form, and it's been Gene. If I mention anything today, is it okay if I ask them to let you know, Gene, or Deborah? I'll be glad to send it back as an e-form to Gene. Just say I want a copy of it. But what we ask in this, we've probably done 700 centers now, a readiness assessment to change or change management. Does your organization have a formalized annual long-term goals for annual planning? If yes, what's the percentage of attainment from your FY 2011 plan? And what we're finding across the country is 20%. 21% of our goals are being accomplished with our annual plans. So what's wrong with that?
79%.
They also have 79% or not, and it's usually system noise. Well, we can't get there because people will be upset. Are y'all familiar with upset? Well, three of them will leave us if we go that way. They just will be upset. Are y'all familiar with this? And I'm not being cheeky here, folks. I'm saying this is critical. You know, leader and a manager means you're going to lead and manage. And you've got to get beyond, I've got three people upset. If you think it needs to happen to meet these values. Because you work for your agency. You know, you're employed by the agency. But, you know, other questions. If the organization does the change management plan, does it do it quickly, move time and decision making, false or true? When the decision is made, the organization act quickly to fully implement the change, true or false? When the change is implemented, staff members rarely retreat to the way it was, true or false? And if you're answering false on these questions, you've got challenges as leaders. Does that make sense? You've got challenges because the changes we're talking about are not lightweight. They're heavy, heavy duty. And all of a sudden, we're going to be talking cost in meetings. And remember the days when we weren't supposed to talk cost with clinicians in the room because we didn't want to sway them? Are y'all familiar with those? Those ethical things back in the 80s and 90s? We can't talk about cost. I don't want my clinicians to know about cost. Anybody with me? A little bit different ballgame, okay? But the question is, and you may want to have your management team, you may want to answer this. If you want to send it to me, I'll be glad to take a look at it and give you some suggestions. But if you're looking at, we can't really do a good job evaluating our outcomes when we change, or we basically, the change process, feel our staff doesn't really feel fully empowered, then what can you do differently as you start again? It's not good or bad, it's just what can you do differently? And what's your difficulty in change? And clinical practice and what's your speed of change? Is rapid or you totally fail to actually implement the change? So again, it's about how can you assess yourselves and how you are in this model. I was asked to serve last June in a national panel for the future of behavioral health. It's up in Washington. National Council asked me to be a panel. The facilitator asked a question. They said, what is the future, the largest challenge facing the behavioral industry in our future based on former care act health care reform? My answer was the willingness for behavioral health leaders to continually step across the threshold of risk to make bold and creative decisions about service delivery processes and methods. And secondly, to stay with those decisions once they make them. That's what I see as our challenge. I just did a leadership institute the day before the council started in D.C. And we're doing leadership essentials all over the country. The biggest thing, training, the biggest challenge for our leaders is we're not willing to make risky decisions. And how we don't get risk is we make sure everybody's okay. If y'all okay with it? Well, if you're not okay with it, let's not do it. Instead of saying, I've got to change, this is not working. My costs are well out of line with what we can afford. As a leader, I've got to do something different, which means I'm going to make a decision. Everybody with me? Questions about that? How are y'all with that? Is it basically a herd concept? Everybody has to be okay with it? Questions, please. If people aren't okay with it, do you move forward with a pilot and see if it works? Do it?
Yes, sometimes.
Sometimes? See, risk means I'm not sure, and everybody's not okay with it, but based on the data, based on the cost, based on the process, based on what we know we've got to do, let's try this Monday morning. You know, one medical director said to me, and to Scott, they went to just-in-time meds, which we're doing a lot of those right now, basically meds within 72-hour cycle, now within 72 hours, and it's working beautifully across the country. But this medical director said, well, I know what we got. We've already talked with another center that you refer us to. We got your procedures. We're going to start next Monday. And her team said, we can't start Monday, because it was a Monday, by the way. And she said, of course we can. We're going to learn from the first minute we do it. But we're not going to sit here and debate it for 6 months to get everybody happy with it. Everybody with me? That's leadership. That's what I'm talking about here. Okay, that's a medical director taking lead. That we're going to learn from this, and we'll meet the first hour, the end of the first hour, the first 2 hours, we'll meet at lunch, but we're going to refine this. We already have the model. It's already been given to us. We're just going to refine it for us. Okay? Now, sequential change versus a quality improvement process versus transformational change and continuous quality improvement process. What we tend to see in the old days is sequential change. But what does that mean? We're going to do this statement before we do that because we can't get too many balls in the air. So we'll do the EMR, and then we'll look at our access, and then we'll look at centralized scheduling, but we're going to do it sequentially over time. What we've got to do today is transformational. Because in your plan, project plan with Joy, you're going to be looking at collaborative documentation, access to care, no-show, engagement level management, all at one time, and centralized scheduling. And how is that working in community and in clinic? All at one time, that's called transformation. We don't have time to do one thing at a time. Does that make sense? And the next thing is we're not going to try to make it perfect, QI. And perfect means everybody's happy with it. We're going to come to a continuous quality improvement that we're about 80%, 85% feel that we're in the right path here. Let's go pilot it, Dale. Start Monday morning, let's look at it Monday afternoon and see how it went the first day. Or look at it at lunch Monday, Dale. But we're going to move forward. We're not going to keep talking about how this might work. We're going to actually do it. That's that decision making. Okay? The other thing is moving from strategic planning to strategic business development. And I did a workshop on this at the conference, and this is a new area the council wants us to look at because what we're finding is that the business model for our behavioral health centers have got to change. And the behavioral model from the leadership perspective has got to be looked at. I've got to look at from strategic planning to strategic business development. What does that mean? And let me take you a little bit further. In strategic business development, I've got to look at the external efforts. Like you were just saying, Deborah, could we go to an NCO and say, if we get together, can we use this outcome? That's external. Is that our strategic business model? Internally, what do I need to do to change to a high-performing, customer-friendly, center of excellence, which the council has published. If you haven't read it, please read the center of excellence material that Dale Jarvis has created, and I've helped him with that. But the point is, I need to understand what my internal challenges are and my external. And then the question for strategic business development core elements are, how will we earn the revenue support strategic initiatives? Understanding grants are probably not going to be what we used to get. Who, what, when, and where are going to be doing this innovation? It addresses organizational structure, management, culture. And this is really important. Ray Wolf, who COO over at Pittsburgh Mercy, Behavioral Health Pittsburgh Mercy Medical Center in Pittsburgh, he co-presented with me on this workshop, and he said the biggest challenge they had is the cultural change. It's just getting the leaders to understand that they were leaders, and that they had to start making some decisions that were tough, that they couldn't keep talking through the processes and making everybody okay. And I'm not saying do not care for people. Please don't hear that. It's a pendulum again. But at some point, when are you going to pull the trigger and do it and learn from it? That's CQI. CQI means I'm going to basically try Monday and learn from it by basically rapid cycle change. I'm going to look at doing it, planning it, doing it, evaluating it, and redoing it if I need to because it didn't work the first time. Okay? Now, I want to come back to be supported in more risk-based and timely decision focus. And how can you start to look at that and get more and more comfortable with that? Requires assessment of operational processes and costs. And if we're talking about that, and we have all morning. It includes market share, branding, and customer service. That's what we're going to talk about next in our next session. Essential elements, ability to obtain outcome data. Reporting it, managing it, and making sure the staff have it. It's not just having outcomes on the ship. And here are the four basic business models. And what I'm suggesting to you is you need to decide one of these models. Okay? And typically, the model that we have, in many cases, is how to earn additional revenue. With our same facilities, with our same processes, with our same staff, how can we generate more revenue? If you have a revenue challenge. And or, how do we reduce costs? We have the staff, we have the buildings, but our costs are really outside of the norm. And you will find out about your access to treatment. Our costs are above national average, or they're within national average, or they're below national average. And Joy will tell you that and show you data. But if, in fact, it's above, what are we going to do to reduce that cost? Everybody with me? That's another. And or, my willingness to participate in partnerships and mergers and grow my market base. Am I willing? Do I know who the partners are potentially out there? Am I looking at strategic meetings with them? Am I at the hospital systems who are moving into ACO status? Do I have people at their board meetings and understand where they're going with their ACO and how we might help them? You know, strategically, am I looking at partnerships? And or, catch the and or, because it can be all of them. But you have to have a primary focus. What's your primary focus? And or, ability to diversify. You know, here's where we are with Beech Brook now, here are the services we offer, but if we diversified and added this, it might help us with this ACO and this partnership. Everybody with me? Okay. Question?
I fully understand the need to lead change, and sometimes that means making decisions that are unpopular and dirty to the group. I'm not saying it's a simple matter. One of the challenges that I think we're facing, though, is that when people get irritated and walk, they're not easily replaced in the world because it's a management employee, at least in the world as it's currently designed.
Right.
So I guess I'm struggling with this idea about leading change and doing what needs to be done in a quick and timely way and then try to help people come along as best you can. But if, you know, if three or four people walk out, you can't do the work. You know, you're sort of I feel like sometimes we're in a double bind.
Sure. Well, it is a double bind. And I think this, if you look, and I'll be glad to pull up data for you and show you centers, but centers who moved to same-day access, like Allen Hart, over Ben Gordon, if you look at the centers who've made this clinical change and accountability change, they're not losing staff. They're maintaining them. In fact, Ben Gordon went from 37% staff turnover to 4.5% in a period of 3 years. Show you the data. The key thing about this is you can't say as leaders like this room, we're now going to change the whole world and good luck, staff. You've got to demonstrate to them how to do it. You've got to train them in weekly supervision, one-on-one or group supervision, what they can do to meet the standard. You can't just dump it on them. And so leadership requires, and I'm going to talk about in customer service, you need to do customer service supervision. And you really need to help them to understand how they can thrive. And when that occurs, we don't have staff turnover. But where leaders say, yeah, we made the decision, y'all just going to have to go out and do it. Yeah, staff, I don't know how to do that. That's not their job. Their job is to be led by you, trained by you, mentored by you, coached by you. And so it means that you've got to get more active in those exercises. I have sample supervision plans. Be glad to give them to you. Sample supervision logs, four types of supervision. All of these tools are here. Be glad to give them to you. But the question is everyone here getting adequate and appropriate coaching and mentoring supervision? Some people getting some people not getting it. I'm seeing a lot of no's being checked. You've got to address that. You can't just say, Brook has decided to go this way. Your staff will be absolutely alarmed. It's anxiety, which is appropriate. I don't know how to do that. Then your job is to help them to do that. Get them to trenches work. Make sense? You know, when we were going through change in 1991, I used to walk the halls every day. I took 2 hours. And part of our challenge as leaders today is we're spending, on average, from the surveys I'm doing with centers for when I come in for leadership essential training, is they're spending 4 to 4.5 hours a day on the computer answering emails. And guess what the rest of the day is spent? In meetings. So where are their staff? What are their staff doing? And I'm going to say, here's a change. Go for it. But I won't be in my computer for 4.5 hours because everybody's doing replies. Are y'all familiar with that? And also, a couple of rules on time management on emails. Start putting in the refer line to red, yellow, or green. Green means answer it when you can. Yellow, I need it this week. Red, I need an answer as soon as you can. So when you get an email from Dale and it's red, you can pull it immediately into a red priority. So when you have 10 minutes between meetings, guess what you can look at? Your priority. Instead of having to open one email at a time to determine. Second thing is don't, and this is what we do in leadership essential, don't, an email cannot be more than 4 bullets, not 12 pages. If you have more than 4 bullets to say in an email, call me. Does that make sense? And particularly don't send 12 pages to 22 people. Everybody with me? Because you've got to get off the computer. You've got to get off. You can't be your slave. You can't be a slave to it. You've got to be with your staff in this transition. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm not sure if this is the right time or not. I'm just going to table me.
Whatever.
But you're explaining the leadership challenges that are going to need to be made and why. You made one reference to if, I'm going to say provider doesn't get in the parade, and doesn't build a flow and get in the parade, they're going to be on the sidelines. And then what? So could you just talk about the danger of not making a transition?
Very good. I think the danger is this, and I use a parade analogy because I think it's a good one. If I'm watching the healthcare reform parade, that's what we're going to call it, the 4th of July, we're going to have a healthcare reform parade, and I see, here's a hospital system, here's a medical center, here's Cleveland Clinic, and I'm not on their float, haven't been invited to be a part of building their float, I don't have a float in the parade because I don't have really any ability to have a float, but we're over here watching all this happen. Then the challenge is in about 2 to 3 years, the reform will have happened. Everybody with me? The law has certain timelines in it. And by 17, the reform will have happened. Now, the point is, if I wasn't on a float, wasn't helping build a float, didn't have my own float that said, we are specialty, we can do it by ourselves, you know, that's a specialty float, then what is our role standing on the sidelines? On the sidelines? And the answer is, I'm not sure. And what we're finding with these certified community behavioral health clinics, Deborah, if in fact a state department says we don't have behavioral health centers in our state that can meet the federal standards, and they start creating their own to meet the standards so they can get in the game, then guess what's going to happen to those that were not identified as certified? Their only hope is to be a specialty, just a core specialty provider. And they pick up the pieces.
And what is core specialty provider? When you talk about how specialty?
It could be a residential provider. It could be a crisis provider. For instance, a lot of crisis needs right now. A couple of companies have started to build crisis centers. So that's that core specialty. You could be in a therapy role or a case management role, but that's going to be the MCOs running the care management. You know, unless they pass it down to you and get a contract for it, you know, that role's going to be pretty gone. And so the therapy role, and then you're going to be competing with every other therapist in town. Make sense? So your old, we are Beech, Brook, you know, we have this model, and this is who we are, starts to get broken down unless you reestablish who you are through an integrated care or more shared risk funding model that I talked about. Without it, your identity will become smaller and smaller. Because what will be left with team And this is what one team asked me. So what's the big deal? So we don't get on the parade, or get on the flood. And I said, well, then you're going to be left with United Way grants and county grants. Is that where you want your future for your staff? That's really where it's going to be left. Because all the Medicaid and Medicare is going to be managed. Private insurance, you don't want to go on their panels because you don't like to do all the hoops for private insurance. Well, you don't have to, but what are you going to be left with when all this is said and done? Does that make sense? So it's real important. And so when you build your business model, you've got to decide where your focus, primary, secondary, and tertiary, might be. And I would suggest you have to have a primary focus. It can't be, I'm going to do all four. What's your primary? What are you going to do in the first 6 months? When we do these business models, we then build a 45 to 90 day plan with them. In other words, if our focus, basically, Gene, is going to be on willing to participate, what are we doing in 45 days to accomplish that? First 90 days. And so I'm starting to look at real time effectiveness in meeting those goals, because we don't have time. Here are the typical readiness areas. I won't read all these to you. This is what I've been talking about for 22 years. But basically, centralized scheduling, community-based, will call, measure, engagement management, outcome assessment, all the things I've said, collaborative and current documentation, authorization, pre-authorization, internal payments. Part of our biggest challenge nationally is that most of our centers have very skewed payer mixes. A team stopped me in D.C. and said we were 70% grant, 21% Medicaid, and the others county funding. Do you think we got a problem going into our future? And the answer is what?
Yeah.
You really do. No payer should be over 30% of your mix. Why? Because when they sneeze, you get a moment. Well, you need diversity. Are you with me? I need multiple payers. So if someone sneezes or changes the rules, I still got 66% or 70% over here that I'm not being heard. So I start looking at payer diversity. Revenue cycle management. Michael Floor and our team does a really good job with that. He's doing a back office grant right now. So really what we're talking about here is a process of change. How do you come together? You're going to have a gap team, you're going to have a couple teams that work with Joy. That's the process of change. But the key thing for you, and I want to put this slide in, is you've got to have buy-in. If you don't buy in, then your staff can't get beyond you. Does that make sense? And in fact, it looks like this. Where I see most teams struggle is what I call the 1-2 dance. The 1-2 dance. The one dance is, when we're going to change, we're going to change our access, because that's your next challenge, working with Joy. We're going to change our access to care. First thing staff will say is, why? We've been doing this for 22 years. I've used this form forever. You know, why? I like my form. Are y'all familiar with those? I like my yellow form. I like my green form. I like my blue form. I like it. So why do I have to change? That's called denial. So let's talk about it in terms of dollars and cents. Objective. Here's the delay concept. Here's how many days, how many hours of delay. Here's the loophole and the flow chart. And here's your cost. That gets us past denial. Then it's, well, if you're going to change it, I would like to have my team a little bit different than the rest, because we don't want to standardize, because we're different. Y'all familiar with different? My staff is different. My location is different. You know, my computers are different most days. I mean, really, most Mondays we can't fire them. I mean, you know, but so we just can't quite do it the way y'all want to do it. So we need to negotiate. And the minute we stop negotiating, they get angry. Anxious is what I call it. They start blaming. Okay? I've been blamed for a lot. But the point is, the minute, and this goes back to what you were just saying, if we're being held hostage by our staff, and I need to say that, because that's what it is. And I'm afraid they're going to get so upset that they might leave, I'll back up to negotiation. Well, maybe we won't implement it next Monday. We'll wait another month. Y'all familiar with another month? Are you? And if you are, you've got to stop. You've made a decision. You've done your planning. You said, this is what we're going to roll out. We're going to do it on Monday, and here's how we're going to study if it works. We're going to evaluate it. See, you don't have to be perfect if you evaluate. If you never evaluate the outcome, you have to be perfect going in. That's why we spend so many months trying to be perfect. That's the QI approach. CQI is, we're not going to be perfect. Let's just try to get an idea and learn from it. Let's see what we can learn from this on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday. And we'll change it every day if we have to. But we're going to have leaders in there watching it, observing it, doing it. One COO said it took them 10 days to go to same-day access. I said, how do you know it's 10 days? She said, because I sat at the front desk every day for 10 days. And she said, every problem came up, we solved it on the moment, we did it again. We changed it, we did it again. And she said, after 10 days, there was no more challenge. That's called leadership. That make sense? Okay. Get angry. Now, what happens is the dropout, it's awful, I'm going to leave it back on this, I've never gone and gotten a MSW degree. One told me the other day she had gone into computer services and made some money with her life. Acceptance of the need to change and then get excited. See, what you've got to be, and this is important, leaders, on any topic, performance, on changing access, whatever cost finding, whatever you want to talk about as a topic, wherever you are in this 1 to 6, wherever you are individually, your staff cannot get beyond you. Everybody understand that? You've got to get the 6. And see, leadership's responsibility is to get the 6. So we can lead and pull our team through this process. This is a grieving process. Kubler-Ross, would y'all agree? Death and dying. And it's a grieving process. You know, when some staff give up some of the processes they've used for 20 years, it is grieving. Understand that, but don't stop the process because of it. Understand that they're going to get angry. Understand that they're going to feel like they should just leave. But the question you might ask them on the dropout phase, always ask is, where are you going to go? That will not be involved in integrated health care, will not be involved in the Accountable Care Act. It's a federal law. Where are you going to go? And if you can find that place, then fine. But we're going to be moving into a new area of wellness, and we really would love you to be here and learn about this new process with us. See, that's what I'm doing. It's challenging to learn. Questions or thoughts? Where do y'all think you are?
Individually
or organization? If you want to share where you are individually, that's fine. And it's different on different topics. If I talk about ethical challenges, you're probably all at 6. Right? It's either ethical or not. Performance challenges, turning in paperwork, where are you?
2.
Negotiating. Yeah. And the question is, how long are you going to do it? You've got to come to that decision. And that doesn't mean you go to say, people get out. You say, I'm going to sit with you, catch my coaching. I'm going to sit with you and I'm going to help you learn how to do collaborative documentation. I'm going to give you training for that. Or there's a webinar that you can observe. But we're going to do this differently because it's not working for you or for us. I don't want you behind anymore. I don't want you to go home behind. I want you to go home finished. See, that's my hope for you. How can I help you do that? But I'm not going to continue to talk about it every 3 weeks or 6 weeks into the summer. Thoughts or questions? Behaviors, where are you? Staff behavior. Come to work late, come to work, don't come to work late. Where are you?
3. 3?
People are upset? Okay. What about attitude? Can you catch my point, team?
Yeah.
Really important. Because wherever you are, your staff will not get past you. That's really important to understand. Has this been helpful this morning?
Yes.
Okay. Can you see the new frontier? Can you see where we're going? Shared risk, shared savings, value. What does value mean? And we've got to define it, and we have to define it as hard as we can every day from this point on. We have to redefine the continuum.
Just take 3 to 5 minutes. What's the bubble over your head, though? I just want to hear some reaction to what you're doing, what stands out for you. Yeah.
Just how to do it. Just, you know, I think we do some of that. You know, we talk about staff and paperwork. I think we do sit with them. And I think, if we do work with them, it's, you know, how do we do this together? And it's still a cycle. So I think the tools are very exciting to hear.
Models, meeting the people in different positions. So that's a little scary, but moving to number six, exciting, great opportunity.
And can I comment on that, because it's a very important point you've made, is that in your business model development, when you look at your organizational structure to see if it will support your business, it's very important to take that organizational structure and take all names off of it. And talk about the role you need, the expertise you need, or what the experience you need in those roles, and then fit people back to them. But sometimes when we get names in it, we just continue to move along, and it's not going to effectively change the organization.
Julie.
Assuming that you haven't been secretly observing Beechbrook, it seems like this is really touching a lot of things that you know, at least I experienced with different staff and things like that. So the fact that you already know this and other agencies probably you know, have the same experience, it sort of gives a little bit more hope to say, all right, you have these tools that we can use and, you know, customize to whatever works, you know, the best for us. I think that is actually kind of hopeful, as opposed to like in the face of the scary part. So when you were saying it was scary, I'm like, yeah, but there's other people going through this too, which kind of makes me feel a little better.
In fact, I've written three books, co-authored the last book with our team, but the first two, and people have asked me, they said, how did you write this about us? And it wasn't about us. It's about the concept, and the reason that we, candidly, in terms of our management and challenges as leaders, is the way we were paid. You know, I go back to that as the core differentiator. You know, if we've been paid shared risk funding from day one, if we've been paid differently from day one, we probably would not be where we are today. It's not good or bad, it's just, like you said, how do we start shifting? And that's what all the teams in the country are going to have to